Good morning. It's good to see you here. We are a little bit less than our normal attendance, but based on some of my conversations, we have a lot of people joining us online. So we're glad to have you all here. I have two announcements. One is, obviously, there is a bout of COVID going around. We will be discussing this week whether we hold the garage sale as planned or if we postpone it for a week or two. The other thing I've been asked to tell you is there's a little slip of paper in your bulletin that has to do with Sunday school. Dina planned to be here to collect those this week. She is not able to attend, so she asked that you could take those home, fill them out, and bring them back next week. I don't know, Phyllis, do you want them this week?
How you doing?
Okay,
how you
thank doing? You.
We're also going to have like a table set up in the back for if you want to sign up or find out if you want to come to school, just kind of see a D&D over there and
come over
to
study. Great. So we do plan Rally Sunday for September 11th. So please plan to join us then.
Probably. Our opening hymn is printed in the bulletin. Please stand and face the cross. And confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord who has begun this good work in us bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who suffer here, their worship and praise, let us praise to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Genesis 18.
The Old Testament. The Old Testament reading is from Genesis 18. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre as he sat at the door of his tent in the heat of the day. He lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, three men were standing in front of him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent door to meet them and bowed himself to the earth and said, O Lord, if I have found favor in your sight, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought, and wash your feet, and rest yourself under the tree, while I bring a morsel of bread, that you may refresh yourselves. And after that, you may pass on, since you have come to your servant." So they said, "Do of you as you have said." And Abraham went quickly into the tent to Sarah and said, "Quick, 3 seas of fine flour kneaded, and make cakes." And Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, gave it to a young man who prepared it quickly. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where is Sarah your wife?" And he said, "She's in the tent." The Lord said, "I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah your wife shall have a son." And Sarah was listening at the door of the tent behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in years. The way of women had ceased to be with Sarah, so Sarah laughed to herself, saying, "After I'm worn out and the Lord is old, shall I have pleasure?" The Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old?' Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you about this time next year, and Sarah shall have a son." This is the word of the Lord. Psalm 27 will be read responsively. "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is my stronghold and my life. Of whom I shall be afraid?
When evil doers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it will be they that stumble and fall.
Though an army encamps against me, my heart shall not fear. The war rises against me, yet I will be confident.
One thing have I asked of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple.
For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent, and he will lift me high upon a rock.
I will lift up above my enemies all around me, and will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen."
The epistle is from Colossians 1. "You who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he who now reconciles in this body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him, if indeed you continue in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and of which I, Paul, became a minister." This is the word of the Lord.
Hallelujah, Lord, to him go. You have the words of eternal life. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
The Holy Gospel, Luke 10. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 10th chapter. "Now as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. But Martha was distracted with much serving, and she went up to him and said, 'Lord, you do not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me.' But the Lord answered her, 'Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion which will not be taken away from her.'" This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you,
Lord Christ. We recite the Nicene Creed. "I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
with all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will rise again, living the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the worship of the Father and the Son, together is worshiped, and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Our sermon today has to do with, is anything too wonderful for God? Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The Word of God we'll be talking about is the story of Abraham and Sarah from Genesis chapter 18. But first, I'd like to also call your attention to the rest of the story as it appears in chapter 21. I'll read it for you now. The Lord visited Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did to Sarah as he had promised. And Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age at the time of which God had spoken to him. Abraham called the name of his son Isaac. And Abraham circumcised his son when he was 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born. And Sarah said, God has made a laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh over me. And she said, who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age. When God comes into someone, did you notice that Sarah said, God has made laughter for me? It's a remarkable development. Considers just showed up in chapter 18 to announce Sarah would bear a son. Her laughter was cynical and filled with doubt. But something changed. This chapter 21 laughter is what God brings. That chapter 18 cynical laughter is what we know all too well. We don't give God enough credit for the wonders he can do, especially when we don't see his hand working at all. So, how can God transform our cynical laughter into something more resembling pure joy? That's what we hope to learn from the story this morning as we observe that, one, God comes to Sarah, two, how God comes to Sarah, and three, why God. God comes to Sarah, not Abraham. It's easy to miss this as we read through the text, especially since we're so accustomed to hearing Abraham as the central human figure in so many of these texts. And God has certainly already come to Abraham, promising to make him and his offspring in a new society of people who bear his promise. Abraham has had his moment. Genesis 18 is Sarah's moment. Notice in verse 9, after Abraham had finished running around in preparation for a meal, they look at Abraham and say, where's Sarah? They're here for her, not him. And oh, by the way, those three visitors are the Lord and two angels, at least. That's how I read the text. So God has come to Sarah, which is important because up until now, Sarah's knowledge of God has always been through her husband, Abraham. Of course, Sarah knows all about this God. Abraham has been telling her for decades about God has promised them a large family and a blessed life. Sarah's heard it all. You might even assume she's grown a little bit tired of it. And that is our first point. It is not enough to know God through someone else. It is not enough to simply know about God. You need to know God. He needs to grab hold of you to take this life of yours and make it something new. God comes to Sarah. And what if you had not done that? Would Sarah have spent the rest of her life doubting her nutty husband Abraham and his crazy stories about the God who keeps his promises? We can't say, because this is a story of Sarah's redemption. Now think about yourselves for a minute. Many of you had this kind of encounter with God, and as a result, your life was transformed. Many of you have become generous than you ever expected you'd be, more enraptured by the gospel, more engaged with the church. But how many of you still feel like you know about God, but you haven't really met him personally? If that's you, I'd like to invite you to get involved in small group. Take a look at the bulletin insert that lists many opportunities you have here at Good Shepherd to let God come to you. Small groups are perfect for the same kind of encounter that Sarah has had. And if you're thinking to yourself, this is not for me, then I'm suggesting that is the same kind of cynical laughter that God comes to Sarah to transform. Join a small group. Meet the living God. Revelation 3:20 says it best, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him, and he with me." That's what life with a small group is all about. It's a way of knocking on the door that cannot be done on a Sunday morning in this sanctuary. It's a way of moving from knowing about God to knowing God. So I urge you to join a small group. Now, how does God come to Sarah? He comes to Sarah in the most gentle and loving way you can imagine. After God says that Sarah is going to bear a son, Sarah says something about herself that is very negative. She calls herself worn out, used up, basically good for nothing. Then she says, "At my age, am I to have this pleasure?" I want you to know something she's talking about there, because it's another sign of how bitter and cynical she has become. That word for pleasure has nothing to do with bearing a child. In fact, if you think giving birth to a baby is a pleasure, you're probably a man. Sarah is saying, "My husband hasn't touched me in years. I'm 90. He's 100. My life is over. There'll be no more joy." She laughs in God's face because she has lost the capacity for wonder. She says all of this in verse 12, but in verse 13, God could say to Abraham, "Why is your voice so cynical? Why is she so bitter? Why is she sinning in this way?" But he doesn't. Sarah's just laughed at God, but when the Lord restates her objection, he is gentle. He doesn't say, "How dare you doubt me, you little human speck?" No. He takes all the self-depreciation language out of her objection. Look at verse 13. He just says, "Why did Sarah laugh?" Do you realize how gentle and loving God is with your objections? Do you realize that no matter what it is that seems to be interfering with a deeper relationship with him, those things are always our own sin? God does not lower the hammer. He forgives. God forgives all your sin. That's how God comes to Sarah, and that's how God comes to you. He comes in forgiveness, which is why he comes for Sarah, and it's why he comes for you. His forgiveness is a great wonder. Look at the diagnosis of Sarah's problem. He says, "Why did Sarah laugh?" Then he says in verse 14, "Is anything too hard for the Lord?" The Hebrew word God uses there is actually the word for wonder. It's the word you've heard over and over in the Psalms, telling about his awesome wonders. It's the word that describes his miracles, his signs and wonders. What the Lord actually says to Sarah is this: "Is anything too wonderful for the Lord?" The Lord's diagnosis of Sarah's problem is simply she's lost the capacity to be amazed by God. So God has come to give Sarah wonder. You know what wonder is. You see it in a child's face when you take him to the zoo. He can't believe his eyes. Wonder is that inner sense that there is more to the world than just wake up, work, eat, go to bed, repeat. Wonder is a gift from God, who alone created this world and whose power over it is complete. So let God fill your heart this morning with wonder. Let him show you how, even though it might look and taste like ordinary bread and wine, it is, in fact, the body and blood of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Talk about a wonder. Let God remind you that though he was dead, he has risen from the grave. Wonder? You bet. Let God show his love for you, that while you were still deep in sin, he died for you, forgives you, and brings you laughter, true joy. May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, your Lord. Amen. We sing our sermon hymn. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all.
you for mercy. We ask for courage, wisdom, stamina to do thy will. We ask for healing, comfort, and peace for our sick. We pray for our missionaries. We pray for our church that we continue to follow thy will. Please hear our prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, Almighty and everlasting God, you have safely brought us to the beginning of this day. Defend us in the same with your mighty power and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all of our doings, being ordered by your governance, may be righteous in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Our closing hymn is number 802. Thank you.